professor John Nash. Ho dimenticato di dire che faremo l'intervista in inglese per semplicità, credo che molti di voi avranno le cuffiette, quindi potrete seguire quello che diremo. Professor Nash, first of all, thank you very much for being here, for accepting to give this interview. Your first impression of the festival, what do you think?
Well, it looks like it's successful because of the numbers.
Aha, only because of the numbers?
Well, you have the idea of the festival, and then you have the results, and the numbers of people around indicate how the idea is being achieved.
Uh-huh. You know that the numbers are more than 50,000 people attending in 4 days. And there are 3,000 people in here and many more outside, so just to listen to you. So I think that we can start from this morning, since you were here this morning on the same stage and you played chess, first of all. How was your game with Boris Spassky first?
Well, my game was very much of an amateur's game. See, I'm really an expert on computer access to internet chess. I'm not an expert on playing the internet chess, but on arranging the access, finding places where you can do it.
Do you do it for yourself or for your friends or family?
Well, it's set up in the house so that we can play various games. And Johnny has played chess and checkers.
He also played this morning, incidentally, for a short time.
Very short, yes.
Uh-huh. You told me, for example, that there was a move that you didn't like, that so to speak, you regretted this morning.
Well, you regret a mistake when you make a mistake. There's one point where Spassky pushed his bishop forward, and there was a standard move that one could push a pawn forward to push the bishop back. And that seems so obvious that I said, I thought that Spassky did it, maybe that wouldn't be a good reply. But I think maybe it was just what I should have done at that point.
Uh-huh.
But I don't know.
But being a mathematician, on top of being also a chess player, I would like you to comment, if possible, on a question that we raised this morning with Spassky, but it didn't like to answer too much. Namely, you think that there is a relationship or a parallel between the game of chess on one side and mathematics on the other side?
Well, there's certainly a parallel with computer science because it's possible to develop a very powerful program to play chess, and Go is much more resistant to on that level. I think it's really a challenge that they should study in Japan.
Uh-huh. But I meant more chess as a metaphor, for example, for mathematics, or conversely, mathematics as a metaphor for chess, that is, similar activities, perhaps, although different.
Yes, well, there's certainly a similarity in the proof of precision. Precision, if you to have a really good play, it has to be analogous to a proof that it's really solid, and you can't find a flaw in any step.
So a mate would be like a theorem, right? Like proving a theorem, in a sense.
Yeah, in a sense, but of course, like a mate can prove that some possible play on the opposing side is not good.
Uh-huh. And, of course, there are also other games that you've been playing. One of them you actually invented. Can you tell us something about what is now called Hex, but I think you called it differently when you invented it, right?
Well, it was co-invented, but as far as I knew initially, I had just thought of this as a game that illustrated some game theoretic concepts.
Precisely which ones?
Well, it was a game in which the first player had an intrinsic advantage, and yet you couldn't easily see how to use the advantage of first player. And this is presumably true of chess, but it's not a theorem. It's one of the things about chess, and no matter how well the grandmasters and the computers can play it, it has not been proved that white has an advantage.
Where and when did you invent Hex?
Oh, that was when I was early in my studies at Princeton, graduate study.
So early 50s or late 40s?
It would have been before, probably around 49. 1949.
And you didn't commercialize it, right? But I think that students actually and your fellow students like to play it, right?
Well, it was played to a certain extent around Fine Hall, which is the mathematics building.
In Princeton.
Yes, and a board was built at which a good hexagonal board, a good board with hexagonal spaces and a large diamond shape pattern. It lasted for many years. I don't think it's not there anymore. It sort of has expired as far as I know.
So you never got any royalties for
it? It was played with ghost stones.
But you never got any royalties?
No, there was an attempt. There was another person, David Gale, who's sort of a game theorist,
right?
And he's older than I am, but he had the idea of promoting it. And there was the attempt to sell it to Parker Brothers, but I think Parker Brothers found that it was not an invention because someone in Denmark had previously invented it, but never called it Hex.
Heim, right? I think.
Yes. And he was a writer on many topics. He had adopted the name of a famous Dutch admiral rather than anyone in Denmark. But Parker Brothers made a version of it. It was only 10 by 10 in the ray pattern.
And your version was instead?
Well, we had a board that was 14 by 14, which is much better for a challenging game. If it gets very small, then the game becomes obvious. It's obvious what to do.
And you proved some theorems about this game, I guess, right?
Well, the theorem is that first player can win.
Has a winning strategy, right?
Has a winning strategy.
But the strategy is not known.
No, it's an existence theorem.
A purely existence theorem?
Yes, it's a theorem by proof of existence by contradiction.
So this leads us a little bit into game theory, right? This is a theorem about games, incidentally,
yes,
right?
I really developed it as sort of a game illustrating some game theory principles and also some topology. Because the topology was necessary to see that, to prove the theorems about it.
And your proof was the same that Milner gave? I've seen one proof, I think, by Milner in the Mathematical Intelligencer a few years ago.
Well, that was essentially an expository article,
which
may have improved on any previous proof, but would not have been entirely new.
So why don't we talk a little bit about the real game theory that you developed in those years? How did you come to be interested in game theory, first of all? Because that was not a popular subject at the time, was it?
Well, it was sort of, you could say, more or less unknown, except von Neumann and Morgenstern had published a book back in 1944 called Theory of Games and Economic Behavior. Right. That was an ambitious title, and their ambition was justified because game theory did become subsequently very much entangled, involved in economics and economists came to depend upon it.
Because of this book also, probably.
Well, the book certainly introduced the theme that that game theory should be important to economics, and it should be possible to develop economics from that point of view, that the game theory would explain behavior in economics. Also.
But were you already interested in economics at the time, or only in the mathematical side of the theory?
I had some interest in economics. I think I've always had some interest. Before going to Princeton, which is a different, I elected to study one economics course besides my mathematics or my chemistry courses.
So you took one class?
Yes, it was called International Economics. Economics. I think it was taught by an Austrian.
And those are the only studies you had in economics?
That's the only formal
official,
class
formal,
that
right.
I had.
And how did you decide the subject of your thesis? Namely, this was a big step forward with respect to von Neumann, right? I mean, going from zero-sum games to any kind of game.
It has come to be viewed that way, but at the time it wasn't so rapidly accepted.
Uh-huh.
But there were a few people who were accepted, like Kenneth Arrow and Gerard Debreu.
But this was later, of course, right? After you did it.
Well, they were influenced by my original publication, uh-huh. I think.
But is there any relationship between the proof, for example, of the existence of equilibrium in the games and the existence of equilibria in economical situations?
Well, what they call this general is a theory of
general equilibrium.
Right. Well, what happened is there was a paper of Arrow and Debreu jointly.
In the early 50s, right?
And they both made use of the Kakadani fixed point theorem. Now, I had just used that, like the year before, in a publication on the equilibrium points, what are now called Nash equilibrium. And I had used the Kakadani theorem. This David Gale, who got involved in the Hex game, he had suggested that to me. I had planned to use the Brouwer fixed point theorem, more basic classical. But so in my first publication, which was one page to the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences.
One page?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
I used
And this
the,
is the big theorem that actually got you the Nobel Prize, right?
That's what they quoted.
Uh-huh.
But it doesn't work quite like that. They cite something, but it's a total
it's
picture.
It's for a more general thing, right?
That determines what they really, I think what they would really approve of. Some of the citations are like evasive.
But how did you get the idea of using a fixed point theorem to prove an equilibrium?
Well, this is mathematics. You know, why do you use a fixed point theorem? There are some things in partial differential equations where forms of fixed point theorems can be used.
Uh-huh. To get solutions to the
yes,
equation.
It can be a case of stability can correspond uh-huh. to a fixed point. There are various generalizations.
Now, of course, von Neumann also had used it, I think, in his work, right? Did you know about it, or?
Well, I knew some. I didn't know everything about every use. The book von Neumann and Morgenstern, they had ultimately arranged not to use the Brouwer fixed point theorem directly. They used something else, which is sort of equivalent.
Uh-huh. So it was disguised in a sense.
Yes, you could say it's, but earlier von Neumann had used it, and he had used it in another publication in the 30s. He had used the Brouwer theorem.
The original publication, right. Where?
That's not the original, that uh-huh. was not his original game theory, which that uh-huh. was to 28.
Yeah, 28, that's what yeah. I thought you meant.
That year when, but later on in the 30s, uh-huh. he had a publication when he was already in Princeton. We had two firms, and he had a type of equilibrium interaction and used the fixed point theorem. And this paper had the effect of stimulating Kakutani, Shizuo Kakutani, to develop the Kakutani fixed point theorem to simplify that. So he was actually stimulated by von Neumann, and in the end, that I used it, and these other people.
So we've been talking about the great man, von Neumann. You probably met him, right? And you even discussed, I guess, some of your results with him.
Yes, well, I met him when I was in Princeton, like in a general way.
After you did your work?
Well, after I would have met him before, probably socially, in a distant sense. You know, some students might see someone around.
Do you have any stories about him? Because, you know, there are lots of anecdotes, and nobody never knows, you know, whether they're true or not.
There are many stories.
And you have some of yours?
I've heard. I don't have really a story of that anecdote.
But did you explain your result to him?
I went to him at one time after I was fairly well along with it, and she said, explain. Of course, it's clearly another way of looking at simple games. And he didn't say too much, but then the thing that he said was surprising. Do you use a fixed point theorem? Do you possibly use a fixed point theorem to prove this?
That's what he said immediately?
Yes. Well, that surprised me, that it seemed like a... But, of course, it wasn't so surprising when I thought later about his use of fixed point theorems and is similar in... The fact that the Kakutani theorem was stimulated by his use of fixed point theorem. And I had also used the Kakutani.
Well, you do have a von Neumann story, actually. You just said it. Well, I think you also have an Einstein story.
But it's
story.
Not like the story of how to calculate the distance traveled by the bee.
What is the story?
Well, I don't know that I believe it. There's a story about two railroad trains are approaching each other at certain speeds. And a bee is flying between one and the other. It's something that has a higher speed. Maybe it's not railroad trains, but then they calculate the distance traveled by the bee. And then von Neumann is supposed to have done it mentally by summing
the whole series.
Yes.
As opposed to using the trick.
The trick is to calculate the time involved and the speed of the bee, multiplied by the speed of the bee, and that gives the distance traveled by the bee.
So is it really true? I mean, people always said that he was so fast and so prolific and so omniscient even. I mean, he seemed to know everything, right? So you got this impression too?
Well, he was certainly very sharp, nobody knows everything.
Nobody knows everything. there was somebody that at least knew a lot, right, which was Albert Einstein. You did have an encounter with him, right?
Well, Neumann might have known more than Einstein. Because Einstein was perhaps more specialized than Neumann.
But you did meet Einstein too, right?
Yes, I met him.
How did it happen?
Well, I had been thinking about cosmology, gravitation, maybe unified fields, radiation, electromagnetic radiation. So I thought that, and also the expansion of the universe. So I thought of a possibility that a light photon traveling through space might be slowed down by an inverse effect of losing energy by generating gravitational waves. Now,
would this be an explanation of the redshift, for example?
Yes. I've seen another person later on, physicists, you know, recognized physicists, bring up the same idea. It's been discussed. But, of course, there are various angles. There's evidence of the expansion the universe is part of this spectrum of the background radiation that fits that very well.
How did you get interested, first of all, in these cosmological questions? I mean, game theory and cosmology seem to be pretty far
away.
Well,
I've always been broadly interested in science. So I guess that's the nature of it.
But then you were saying you went to see Einstein about it, right?
Yes, well, of course, being in Princeton, and you know that Einstein is there, is stimulating. So, well, I think he affected my work in pure mathematics also. Because you know that the space-time is a manifold that's analogous to a Riemannian manifold.
Right.
You have the form of Riemannian geometry, but the change, the symmetric tensor, is non-positive.
Right.
But otherwise, it's formally the same. You have Ricci tensor. Riemann tensor, Ricci tensor. Levi Civitas.
So a lot of Italians actually worked in this field.
Yes, and then Bianchi identities.
Bianchi identities.
Right. There are two types of Bianchi identities that I know.
But then what happened when you went to Einstein? Was it, first of all, easy to get to know him? I mean, you just called him up and...
No. It was not so simple, but of course he did see people, but he...
But you were a student at the time, right?
Yes, well, I don't think he had so much contact with students, like physics students. He had an assistant. And what happened was that his student assistant was sort of someone who had been a student of math and logic.
Oh, Kemeny, by
the way. Yes, Kemeny.
Yeah, John Kemeny.
Well, Kemeny was there at the time when he was there, and I thought he was a little like a security guard.
Like a bodyguard? They thought that you could be dangerous or just...
Well, Einstein could be a target for characters, you know,
for political reasons.
So well known.
And what did he tell you? You explained your theory to him?
I explained the idea. I didn't really have a theory, but I said maybe
the idea.
Maybe this mechanism could be relevant. It might relate to even to unified field theory.
And he accepted it?
Well, he didn't exactly accept it. I talked a little. I didn't have too much time. He said, "Well, you need to maybe really get into a lot of study if you want to think about these things."
So he just sent you back to school, so to speak, right?
Yes.
Right. And you studied and did your big work in game theory in those years. Why don't we see, possiamo vedere il primo filmato, per favore? There's a little piece from the movie A Beautiful Mind that has Santa in the back. It's back in here. And we should see.
Yes, that was one of the history books.
Adam Smith needs revision.
What are you talking about?
If we all go for the blonde. We block each other. Not a single one of us is going to get her. So then we go for her friends. But they will all give us the cold shoulder because nobody likes to be second choice. But what if no one goes for the blonde? We don't get in each other's way, and we don't insult the other girls. It's the only way we win.
Well, of course, this is a little far from reality, right? First of all, the scene never happened, I guess. And what do you think the movie tried to explain? And did it succeed in doing it?
I think it's like other things. It's the work of this screenwriter who seems to be talented, Mortist. You know, the same screenwriter is the screenwriter for the Da Vinci Code.
For the Da Vinci Code, right.
It's the same team.
But what do you think of this particular scene? I mean, this is the only scene in the movie that has something to do with real mathematics, right? And they got it wrong.
Well, it's game theory cannot really be honestly applied to something like that and get that result. But I think there's some more psychology in that. I sort of meditated on it. You know, if Alicia had been a blonde, the screenwriter would have written something different.
But do you think that they were successful in explaining the notion of the Nash equilibrium?
Well, I don't. It's one of those. I don't think there was a serious attempt.
Attempt. And they didn't succeed. And would you like to try? Of course, not to say it in technical terms, but since you invented it, how would you explain in two words or four words the notion of the Nash equilibrium?
Well, it would be, well, if the game can be described in terms of strategies, particularly a finite number of options, like optional play. Well, one example I actually worked out in the time of the thesis, an application to a poker game. Von Neumann had worked on poker games also, but he was restricted to two players. But I could do three players in terms of Nash equilibrium, equilibrium point.
And three and any number would be the same, right?
Well, it's very natural for poker because it's understood in a poker game that everyone is playing solo. There are no gangs, no coalitions. Those secret arrangements, secret treaties. Well, if the poker players could be reduced, which they could in my example, it was very simplified, to a finite number of strategies, that they just play this strategy, and then each player's strategy interacts with the other player's strategies. But a pure strategy is just some interaction. And then they have to make mixed strategies, which is a mix of probabilities applied to the pure strategies. Well, there's equilibrium if each of the three players has a mixed strategy and he cannot improve the mix given that the other players are assumed to have
unilaterally
to have fixed what they're fixed. Their strategies are being fixed. Yeah, unilaterally. He can't unilaterally improve by a unilateral modification of his strategy. So then, if everyone is like that, the three strategies are in equilibrium.
There is an Italian writer, I don't know if you know him, Italo Calvino, and he wrote a famous novel, which is called If on a Winter Night a Traveler. And he has a phrase that some people have taken as a depiction of the Nash equilibrium. He says that sometimes in life we cannot achieve the best, but sometimes we can all avoid the worst. You think that this is a description of?
Well, it's certainly like that. Typically, that you're avoiding the worst and. To achieve the best may require cooperation, but my thesis when I wrote it was entitled Non-Cooperative
right.
Games.
Uh-huh.
It's implied that the players are acting independently.
So we've been talking about Nash equilibrium, and of course, many people even think, you know, that most of your work was done in game theory, whereas instead, very few of your papers in the 50s were devoted to that, right? Why don't we briefly go through some of the concepts that now are used in mathematics that have your name attached to them? Like, for example, what is this Nash blow up?
Oh, that was an idea that I thought of for algebraic geometry relatively late. It was in the 60s, and it was a natural process in algebraic geometry that you would, and it was intended to resolve singularities.
Singularity,
And it does does seem to work in that regard. The thing is whether there was the idea of a canonical resolution of singularities. It turns out, though, there's another process that really should be done first, and then the national can be done.
So this is an ingredient, so to speak, of the
Well, it,
it
could
rest.
Be an ingredient. I, as far as I know, the end of the story is not reached, but...
Not yet.
Well, the singularities problem is considered solved in most interesting varieties, in what they call characteristic zero, which is what isn't prime characteristic.
You've been just saying the word manifold. There's also a Nash manifold. Is this related to this, or is it a different thing?
Well, the phrase Nash manifold has been used, but it corresponds to what I called real algebraic manifold. And I had a paper that was called real algebraic manifold. That was the paper that might have been my thesis at Princeton if the game theory was not accepted, because, see, the game theory is like applied mathematics partly, whereas this would be pure mathematics.
So you had two theses at the time, ready
well,
or?
I had potential two theses. In the end, I took some time in writing that up, and it wasn't finally published until after I left Princeton.
And today you quoted, for example, at the radio, the Nash inequality. What is this?
Yes, well, that's a phrase that was introduced maybe around the 70s or something. It was sometime after I had done a paper in the 50s, late 50s. This was the paper that interacted with the work of Ennio De Giorgi.
This is the one.
There was an open problem about elliptic equations.
Differential equations.
Yes, elliptic partial differential
partial,
equations
right.
in dimensions higher than two. In two dimensions, the corresponding problem had been solved with some difficulty, but there wasn't understanding beyond that. So I got wind of that problem and I started working on it, but I had the idea of linking the elliptic equations to parabolic equations. And I approached it that way. Ultimately, I got breakthroughs so that I could prove it, and I could prove corresponding theorems about the parabolic equations as well. And in the process of that, I used some inequalities and things. And one inequality that I used there later became called the Nash inequality. But this whole project, as far as the elliptic equations were concerned, De Giorgi beat me to the goalpost on the elliptic equations. It was Ennio De Giorgi.
You just said the phrase, right? That reminds us of a competition, in a sense, right? And you even said once that this might have been the reason why neither of you got the Fields Medal in 1958, right?
Well, it's one thinks of that, of course. I think it would have been difficult anyway. It's sort of one might not be quickly enough appreciated. Actually, see, I was only publishing in 58. It would have to be 62, maybe.
Because I think I've read somewhere that, some of the spilled beans, so to speak, that in 1958 you lost the Field Medal just by one vote. And then it went to René Thom instead. You heard this too?
That could have been for the real algebra, the embedding problem for Riemannian manifolds. That was a good work that had come out in 56.
So just to recapitulate, so to speak, you had a thesis on game theory that got you the Nobel Prize. You had this work on algebraic geometry that almost got you the Fields Medal. Then
I don't think the algebraic geometry, it was good, and it later became appreciated more, but I don't think it would have been appreciated enough at that time.
At the time. But in any case,
it's a lot of time. And
but is it a fact, though, that you also heard this story, that you lost the Fields Medal by just one vote?
I didn't hear it.
Uh-huh, because I read it somewhere. And then it must be true, right?
I don't know.
But in any case, this was the end of the 50s, right? And you said you could have gotten it instead in 1962, right?
In 1962, there would be the other work in partial differential equations could have been appreciated at that time if DiGiorgi hadn't done something that was even earlier than mine and covered the elliptic case at least.
Uh-huh. But in 1962, of course, you were already, so to speak, out of mathematics.
I'd already sort of had a breakdown.
Uh-huh. Then why don't we see, possiamo vedere la seconda scena dal film, another scene from the movie, which relates to this period.
Oh, God, no. Did you know that having a hangover is not having enough water in your body to run your Krebs cycles? Which is exactly what happens to you when you're dying of thirst. So, dying of thirst would probably feel pretty much like the hangover that finally bloody kills you. John Nash.
Hello.
Charles Herman. Pleased to meet you. Well, it's official. I'm almost human again. Officer, I saw the driver who hit me. His name was Johnny Walker. Well, I got in last night in time for English department cocktails. Cock was mine. The tail belonged to a particularly lovely young thing with a passion for D.H. Lawrence. You're not easily distracted, are you?
I'm here to work.
Oh, you're right, I see. Crikey. Is my roommate a dick? Listen, if we can't break the ice, how about we drown it?
Hey. I've seen you smiling and I see you smiling now, so why?
Well, that's the imaginary roommate, and they're, you know, the interesting connection that Jennifer Connelly got the Oscar for Best Supporting Actress.
Uh-huh.
And that was Paul Bettany, who's been a successful actor. But Jennifer Connelly and Paul Bettany are married subsequently.
Uh-huh. After the movie, that is, they met on the stage?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That's very interesting. You see this scene and you think about their marriage, but nothing else?
Well, that's something that's that's independent of the scene, really.
Right.
Of course, there's another aspect to that scene. Did you notice the music?
Yeah.
I think the music is of an ancient composer, Hildegard von Bingen.
Uh-huh.
An early German of the prioress of a convent, who composed music.
And why is this strange, or?
Well, I liked ancient music.
Oh, you liked ancient music.
And so this is consistent with my musical taste.
Uh-huh. Did you suggest this music to the, no? So it was just by chance?
Well, they're trying to do what they can, you know, to in their artistic work.
So one could say that the only real thing in the scene is the music, because you like this music, right?
Well, they're trying to introduce a delusional concept. And they go into much more. They have other people that are, I forget the name of this character, but someone comes up. But
you never had visionary delusions, right?
That is the thing, that is relatively rare. There are types of psychotic states that it's more common, but the type that they diagnosed me as schizophrenic. And that, for simple schizophrenia, or the type of schizophrenia, it's relatively rare to have the visual.
And so you had auditory delusions.
I didn't have them initially, but after a few years, I began to have that.
So what were the symptoms at the very beginning, if there was no delusion?
Well, there were delusion, but you see, you don't have to have delusion through something you see,
or something you hear.
Uh-huh. It could be something you think.
So you had delusionary thinking at the time.
Yes.
Like, for example?
Well, if you, it's sort of a hyperbole, but you could imagine a person who should be a Democrat, but thinks that as a Republican, or should be a Republican who thinks as a Democrat.
How would you know if you? I mean, how would you detect that this is a delusion?
Well,
this would be a very effective political attitude, right? If somebody thinks differently, say, "Oh, you're a schizophrenic," right?
Well, it's
you, like, really think you're, for example, in Italy, right? If you vote for Berlusconi, one could say, "Oh, you're a schizophrenic," right? You really are a communist, right?
Well, they have a big election in France now. There's, I think, Sarkozy versus Royal.
Uh-huh.
And there's quite a difference between the sides, I think.
And we once discussed the subject of the relationship between mathematics in general and delusionary thinking or even madness. And I remember you told me that you don't believe there is any connection. You still think so?
Well, I haven't noticed a connection, and mathematicians, but of course it is part of their business and the work to think logically and rationally, just like a chess player. Like Spassky can't play good chess if he's going to make mistakes in the steps of the game. So if a mathematician makes mistakes in the steps of working out a proof, there is no proof.
But you told me that instead you think that logicians could be mad.
That's the paradoxical thing, and I'm not the only one who observed it, since the other one is Giancarlo Rota.
Rota, right.
Put it in the book.
Uh-huh.
And mathematical logic seems paradoxical. There's some oddly behaving characters.
You know that I am a logician, right? You are aware of this.
Yes. Well, it's not 90%. I mean, 30% would be a lot.
Uh-huh. And why do you think there is a connection between logic and madness?
Well, the paradox could be that it is really difficult to there's some intrinsic difficulty in logic and thinking. It's not a closed book. People are still working on
it. That is, you think that the logical thought is too abstract, in a sense, and it detaches you from the real world?
Well, in a sense, it must be introspective, whereas just thinking mathematics, a person does not need to be so introspective. It can look at something that's different from himself. And logic, the logician must look at the logician, in a sense.
And you have some examples, actually, when you gave your speech at the Madrid convention, right, on psychiatry.
It's easy to think of examples.
For example?
Well, for example, Georg Cantor.
Uh-huh.
He didn't have a completely stable mind throughout his life. And then, of course, the philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche.
Well, he was not
he's
a logician.
Not exactly a logician. He's not a mathematical
logician.
I don't know, was he entirely apart from logic or not?
But you've met some logicians that you think were, so to speak, on the verge.
I had a big argument with Harold Kuhn about whether one should mention a certain professor at all. And this professor was never insane or never over the border in some ways, but he behaved very strangely.
I missed who this was?
Well, I'm not naming him.
Oh, okay, good. And this was a professor in Princeton anyway?
Well, I won't say where he was.
Okay.
But he was known to behave quite oddly, and he had one characteristic that mental patients develop often.
Like what?
Of audibly talking to himself.
Talking to himself, okay.
Yes, yeah. While walking around.
Uh-huh. And for example, Gödel also is supposed to have been quite strange, right?
Yes, well, Gödel is an example one could talk about because he's like a death from insanity. When there's insanity, people often kill themselves one way, uh-huh. Or they may do it one way or another. And in Gödel's case, you could say that he killed himself by a mad starvation. The fear
so he
of
let
food.
Himself die, so to speak.
Well, the starvation,
yes,
you know,
right.
The anorexia, and there are these cases, the young girls who think they're not thin enough and they stop eating entirely. It can lead to death.
But in his case, apparently, this was not so much during his lifetime, but in the last period of his life when he lost
late.
His wife.
Very late.
And he was, so to speak, unbalanced by himself, right, so to speak?
It was very late. I'm not sure. He didn't. I think his wife had not died, but she had been sick for a while, and then she ultimately died after him or not. I'm not sure.
She died a few years earlier, right? Or at least she was recovered.
Yeah. Well, I'm not a complete expert, but uh-huh. He had many eccentricities, of course, also.
But you quoted Chess before, just in passing. Isn't there a relationship there, too? Because Chess is also very logical, in a sense. And there are characters, like Fischer, for example. But Spassky this morning named a few other ones, right?
There was talk about Fischer recently.
Right.
Got some inside details.
Uh-huh.
Yes, he's certainly a character, the extreme. It doesn't seem rational.
Uh-huh. But still he can play rationally.
Well, he doesn't really play very well after this type of this. He was world champion for a short time, and then he didn't agree with the rules about Karpov,
right.
And
so he just
Karpov
resigned,
became champion by default.
Right. But in this case, at least, you know, there seemed to be a balance. I mean, he behaved very irrationally, but then he could play irrationally. So don't you think that a mathematician, for example, it was not your case, apparently. I mean, you had this delusionary thinking, as you said, but then you couldn't go on doing mathematics, right?
Well,
so in a sense,
in my earlier years after mental disturbance, there were times of in and out. I would be in these hospitals, and they would, I would be sort of forced into a conformity,
uh-huh.
And I was I was in a thought correction camp, so that my thinking, which was it was irrational, but it was also disapproved of by society. And so I would come back and I would be ready to work. But I didn't have a particularly good position of employment for working. I could work. And I did some good research at times like this. And it was in those times that the Nash blow-up that you mentioned.
Oh, so this was done already after you got ill, so to
yes,
speak.
Yes,
and during some the recess of your
another
illness.
Work, another area of algebraic geometry, and something else about embedding problems.
But this was in the 60s mostly, right?
This is in the 60s.
Could you still work in the 70s and 80s?
In the 70s, I was not working.
At all?
No, but I was adjusting mentally, like in the 80s. In the 80s, you could say I was working on hobby-type work.
Like what?
Well,
always mathematics.
Working with numbers and programs, learning about computers, developing some specific programs and developing ideas. I made transition without having employment. I could still do some research work.
And could you say that, for example, mathematics at some points was actually a help with your illness, or?
Well, if a person has a mental problem, is off the normal track, anything that's like
that
occupational therapy may be good. If a person does something, they if it involves the cognitive functions. One type of psychotherapy that's been introduced more recently is called cognitive therapy. Instead of the standard drugs, you can have some work in, it's not psychoanalysis, but it involves an interaction. A therapist can be interacting with a patient. It might be good.
You said that your problems were mostly, well, at least you know, at some point or at some stage, you had this auditory delusions, right? How would you compare them to delusions that have been recorded in history? For example, Socrates, at least the Socrates that Plato describes, he claims it very often that I didn't do certain things because I heard a voice that told me not to do it.
Well, it's possible.
The diamond, they called it a diamond at the time.
Well, the Bible is full of stories where there is a dream in which someone receives the message of God that so-and-so is.
But dreams are a different thing, aren't they? I mean, one thing is to dream, and another thing is to hear voices, isn't that?
Well, a dream is not considered so hallucinatory, but of course, if you believe in the dream, maybe it is a hallucination.
It could be the same effect, right?
If God doesn't really exist, and you think you hear the voice of God telling you to do something, then what's your state?
So what do you think? I mean, people that claim historically to have heard voices, you think that today they would be classified as schizophrenic, simply?
It would be a dangerous thing to say. Socrates maybe should be advised to be careful what he was saying.
Not to do. And some prophets too, for example.
You can you can imagine if you get the thought. You can get the thought, but if you say you hear the voice, it's maybe not good.
Right. And of course, then after this, you had a recess and then you recovered. Can you see any reason for this recovery, or it was just sheer luck? In other words, you think you did something that helped you in this recovery, or it just happened? So
well, I was thinking, more or less progressively, and sort of really applying mind intellectually and gradually being less distracted by things that were not well founded. I realized that some of my delusional, well, what I could recognize ultimately as delusional thinking had a political orientation, and I could develop a critical attitude towards that. That this politics is really not good, and one should not think so much about politics if one is not politically important, or one cannot know that one is politically important.
You said that you were less distracted. So that makes one thing that, in a sense, you still heard voices, but you didn't pay attention to them, or the voices stopped at a certain time?
There was a process of fading out, like.
Uh-huh. So you don't hear them anymore? Or
no.
Is it just that you don't want to hear them?
No, I don't hear them.
And then, of course, the last period of your life is the one that, after the Nobel Prize, gave you fame and notoriety.
The Nobel Prize made me recognized and put me in the position where there was really reason to work. And so I returned to some problems in game theory.
Uh-huh.
Plus, I also still have interest in cosmology and equations for space-time. I had developed an idea there before the Nobel Prize that I've continued to study a little. And lately, there's something about it that it seems very interesting because, well, it could be that the so-called Maxwell-Einstein equations are wrong.
That is for electromagnetism and gravitation together.
Yes, Einstein was working for something. If you analyze it, his unified field theory would have conflicted with the Einstein-Maxwell equations.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
But he never produced something that was accepted.
Uh-huh.
In those attempts.
So this is one of your recent interests, in other words. So there's still cosmology.
No, I had this, it develops
right.
From before the Nobel Prize in 1994.
And you didn't work on this afterwards?
Well, I've had a continuing interest since that time, but I don't put a lot of time on it.
Uh-huh.
I'm not committing myself to everything.
And you still work on game theory, for example?
Yes, and I consider myself now an expert on money.
On money?
Yes.
Aha. In what sense?
Well, I have a theme of ideal money, and then I have variations on that.
Aha. But before we continue, let's see the last bit from the movie. Possiamo vedere il terzo segmento del film. Because this is connected to the Nobel Prize ceremony.
It's not there.
No, no, it's not there.
I've always believed in numbers, in the equations and logics that lead to reason. But after a lifetime of such pursuits, I ask, what truly is logic? Who decides reason? My quest has taken me through the physical, the metaphysical, the delusional, and back. And I have made the most important discovery of my career. The most important discovery of my life. It is only in the mysterious equations of love that any logical reasons can be found. I'm only here tonight because of you. You are the reason I am. You are all my reasons. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was a very unlikely scene, right?
As a movie scene, it's been very popular, and I get letters of people that are influenced by that. But of course, it's not what they do. Stockholm.
Why don't we see exactly what they did? Perché non vediamo di nuovo il pezzo che è stato trasmesso quando il professore è entrato e che la scena vera e ci fa vedere quanta differenza ci sia fra la realtà e la finzione invece. We're trying to see what really happened instead in Stockholm.
John Hassani, han är ungrare av börden han också och ännu en av dem som tvingades fly västerut på 50-talet. Han är 74 år nu och han har varit professor vid universitetet i Berkeley i Kalifornien. Det är 45 år sedan den då geniförklarade John Nash, matematiker, formulerade sin spelteori. Sen dröjde det inte länge förrän han drabbades av svår schizofreni och var borta från forskarvärlden i 30 år. Och först nu så har hans sjukdom släppt. Och det är väl, kan man säga, något av ett mirakel att han kan stå här och ta emot Nobelpriset idag. Han är 66 år. Och som första tysk får nu Reinhard Selten från Bonn ta emot årets ekonomipris. I alla fall en tredjedel av det. Han och Hassani har arbetat ihop flera år och dessutom gett ut en bok tillsammans. Och i och med det är... Har alla pristagare fått sitt diplom, sin medalj och av pengarna får de faktiskt först på måndag. Och nu nationalsången.
Hassani has died, but Zeltan is going strong.
Right, so if we have to believe the rest of the movie just by seeing, I mean, how much, you know, it reflects reality, then it would be very difficult to believe any word of it, right? How did the Nobel Prize change your life?
Well, I don't like... wouldn't like to go into details, but it just is very fundamental for me. I think for many persons, Nobel laureates, it probably has made much less of a change. I don't know about now. Alfarov might have been considerably affected, but it depends on
because of the Russian situation, you mean?
Well, he... If he hadn't gotten the prize, maybe he might have been in another place.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what would happen to me. Some persons are so well recognized, so well established.
Already before the prize.
Yes. And
that wouldn't change much.
Yeah, they may be expecting it. And when it comes, they're ready, but it doesn't necessarily affect their lives so much.
Uh-huh. And this is to say that instead, in your case, it was very different.
Yeah, well, I was not well established, and so...
So at the time, you didn't have a job, right?
Yes.
I think when you got the Nobel Prize?
That's right.
Uh-huh. So now you do have, well, at least, you know, you have the office in Princeton, right? And but you retire now.
Well, I'm not teaching.
Uh-huh. You don't teach.
So I have a job, but I'm doing research. I don't consider it as trivial or inconsequential.
Uh-huh. And if you had a second chance, so to speak, like this game, you know, that is played sometimes, Second Life, What would you choose? Would you choose the Fields Medal or the Nobel Prize? Are you satisfied having gotten the Nobel Prize at the end of your career?
But see, Atiyah has been here. Atiyah has a Fields Medal, but not just a Fields Medal. So he has also an Abel Prize.
So he got the Fields Medal and the Abel Prize.
Scandinavian
right?
thing.
Right. So in other words, this is a contorted way of saying that you would have liked both, in a sense.
Well, the more the better.
Okay. Too bad we don't have a second chance in life, but at least you did get the Nobel Prize. I think that we more or less reviewed your interest in that at times sad, but also at times happy life. So we thank you so much for having been with us, and we hope to see you again sometime soon. Thank you.
Hope I have other chances.